So, hi everyone, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Leslie Corr, Business Manager for QikServe, and will be moderating today's panel discussions. QikServe powers digital ordering and payment solutions for thousands of restaurant operators in 30 countries around the world. And for today's panel discussion, we shall focus on the role of payments in technology and how technology can increase efficiency as well as help to save costs. Most operators that we speak to today are in a state of reassessment. As an industry, COVID forced change upon us that has benefited some companies in a massive way and negatively impacted many others. So I'd like to introduce our panel members for today. They represent a broad view of the industry with openness and diverse viewpoints and sharing what we know as an industry. So let me hand over to our panel members for a quick introduction. Dan?
Hi everyone, my name's Dan Rodgers. I work with Leslie, I'm the founder of QikServe.
Thank you, Dan. Will?
My name's William Connors, I'm the IT director for the Noble Group, which includes a variety of brands, including Angus Steakhouse, Steak & Company, Ochre, and we have a casino in Blackpool called Coral Island.
Hey everyone, James Lemon. So I'm head of all things travel and hospitality at Stripe. Stripe's a big financial technology company doing a whole range of products and services across core payments, payment connectivity. We'll get into some of it in a bit. You'll see us as products you can download yourself and get working with in technology, or you'll often see us white labeled behind partners like QikServe and others.
Thank you, James. Okay, so let's get into our first question. So our first topic is around invisible payments and channel complexity. So Dan, perhaps over to you. How does QikServe help streamline operational efficiencies with digital ordering aggregation?
So I think from our perspective, and kind of one of the core foundations when I founded QikServe and we started the company was, How do we simplify as far as possible technology for hospitality operators and try and take out some of the complexity around how to implement technology? And one of there were two really key areas that were I came across as really complex. One was point of sale and the other one was payments. And what we found in the early days and even to a certain extent today was, like, on the payment side in particular, you can have multiple merchant accounts to manage, and you've got different revenue streams coming into an operation. You've got stuff coming in from Deliveroo and Uber Eats and your own channels and people walking in, and all of that creates quite a lot of complexity in terms of how you then reconcile that. And at QikServe, what we've attempted to do on the payment side in particular is to try and rationalize the data streams that are coming in from a payments platform and make sure that as an operator, you can see all of those payments in one place without necessarily having to move between one platform and a payments platform. So, and then I think if we do that, then it's going to make it easier for restaurant operators to then manage those payments as they come through.
Great. Thank you, Dan. And Will, from an operator's perspective, how important is things like increasing your average transaction value and maximizing throughput?
Absolutely. I mean, the two key points that we'd always be looking in a system is first speed and second reliability. So in terms of the customer experience, people don't really want to spend a lot of time downloading an app or, trying to figure out how it works. What they want to do is they want to scan and either order or scan, pick up the check and pay, be able to add a tip. And also the staff need to be 100% confident that it's not going to crash and that the customer experience is going to be very positive.
Thank you, Will. And James, for yourself, what is the importance of invisible payments within the industry?
Yeah, I think there's a sense that restaurants, bars, cafes, let's start with the consumer experience. You could always argue it hasn't really been broken, right? Typically, you can just get your card out, you can pay a waitress, you can pay at the bar. But I think what we're seeing now is customers expect just a lot more choice. right? And if you are on the go, you might want to order ahead of time. Or if you are in a rush, you might just want to literally just walk out. Like, that's what you do in when you're ride sharing, right? In like a Lyft or an Uber, you just get out, walk off, and the receipt kind of appears in your email. So I think there's something about consumers wanting something even more simple. And then for operators, I think what we see is actually we have all these individual taps where we might have seen a consumer across multiple sites, but we're missing an opportunity to really think about loyalty and getting them back again and again. So by kind of hoisting up your experience, if you like, from tapping across individual sites to more of a digital, invisible experience, suddenly you can combine payments with loyalty or rewards, and you can start marketing towards that customer and saying, we know this is your behavior. I think we can get you back if we behave in this different way. So it's this combination of just stripping payments out of, you know, tap, 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 kind of no real experience, and actually starting to build a customer experience, which customers frankly start to love, right? A lot of people are choosing where they buy a coffee or where they buy a beer or where they buy a lunch because they're collecting points or they can order ahead and just pick up. So there's a whole range of customer things in play. And I think operators and the tech companies that serve them have just got to make that really simple.
Yeah, makes sense. And that leads us very nicely into digital ordering. So, well, perhaps for yourself, within your role, at the Noble Group, what is your process for selecting digital ordering vendors? Do you have a due diligence process, and what are the key areas that you would look for?
If any of you are looking at digital ordering, what I would do is I would take a macro look at what you're trying to achieve. So credit card payments are paramount. Like if you are, like for example, the Noble Group, we do about 54 million in sales. Like, and our credit card payments every year was £500,000. So the thing is whatever mobile ordering and payment solution you look for, look to the credit card charges that are in the background. You know, there's some out there that are going to try and charge like 3% of your gross sale. Factor that into £50 million, that's an enormous amount. Like, so the credit cards are paramount. Also, too, you want to have features. Like, there's lots of different types of business. You've got a Nando's style, you've got a like a table service style, fast casual, we've even got fine dining. Like, make sure that the customer journey is going to fit what you want. But also, too, in that macro like a view that you're looking at, everything should speak to each other. So you should have like the ordering and payment linking with your CRM system, because for the Noble Group, the marketing director says, God, wouldn't I love to have the ability to identify who my big spenders are? Wouldn't I love to find out who eats halal? This system does it. You don't longer have anonymous customers. You've got a link between what has been ordered, how many times they come, what is their favorite food, what is their spend, how many covers do they bring. This is a way to bring insight into all this information so you can use it and turn it around with your CRM system to then do focused marketing at your customer base that they find appealing.
Great, well, thank you. So Dan, for yourself, so focusing on QR code payment and digital ordering journeys, what operational pain points can QikServe help to alleviate with your technology?
So I think something interesting James said about technology in restaurants, and it is about trying to give your consumers as many ways to engage with you as possible. The massive benefit of moving a payment from a tap and go payment or a chip and pin payment to a digital payment is you immediately build that connection with a customer. And I think that's probably one of the biggest pains for restaurant operators, is that to a large extent their customer base is anonymous. And it's not until they do stuff around like a loyalty platform or something like that, that you then start to get to know them. But moving to a digital payments platform or a digital ordering platform, you capture a lot of that en route to solving a pain point for your consumers. Everyone knows that it's a pain to try and get your bill at the end of a meal. And if you can surface that customer's bill with a QR code or an NFC tag or a link or whatever it is, you can let that customer get out of that restaurant faster. From an operator, your tables turn faster, you've got a digital connection with that consumer. There's all sorts of other benefits. They're more secure payments because invariably they're like wallet or two-factor authenticated payments. So there's this huge benefits, I think, in trying to digitize those kind of transactional elements of the dining experience.
Thank you, Dan. So James, sticking with the benefits of technology, we all know in today's world the staffing issues that we have within the hospitality sector. What's your take on how technology helps and comes into play for operators within the industry?
Yeah, I think when done right, I think it has huge potential. And just to pick up on something Will was saying, before you think, right, what tech am I going to use, you've got to think, well, what kind of business am I building? So before Stripe, I had a startup, and I made every single mistake in the book on technology. But like, oh, there's the latest shiny CRM, and here's a kind of cool marketing tool, and here's something for workforce management. And whether it be the marketing team, just an absolute nightmare in terms of getting systems to talk to each other. If I could have that time again, I guess my recommendation to anyone looking at that, What's your strategy for the next few years? You know, are you a kind of small, medium-sized business that you actually just need to have a one-stop shop partner, right? I'm going to have a partner that does everything, they're good enough, and they hit on all the key components I need. I do want to get into loyalty or rewards. I do want to get into different channels like the food delivery apps. And there's brilliant tools out there for like that. At the other end, if you're really ambitious, you might actually want to build a tech team. You know, you'll be thinking about, well, I need a product manager, I need a technology director. And then you've got way more flexibility, right? You can come to companies like Stripe Direct and start using Stripe's tools. You can be building your own websites, your own apps, your own kind of digital experiences. And then there's the middle ground. And I typically think we find most people are in the middle, which is you need to find two or three really good partners who know how to talk to each other. And they know how to talk to each other in a low code or no code kind of way, where they've really done the hard work for you. And so beyond the websites and the sales chats and maybe the RFPs, it's really worth going deep with each of your partners and going, right, walk me through this customer journey from before they visit, during their visit, the end of the visit, and then kind of loyalty and bringing them back again. What's that actually going to feel like? Who have you really built that for? And I think to kind of move on to your point about staffing, you've then got to go back to your kind of your staff's journey, your team's journey. Or how many tools am I training them in? Are they going to have to log on to five different portals during the course of a shift or even an hour? What's the experience at their head office for marketing, for finance? And what's the experience of my frontline team going from, you know, receiving orders before people arrive or food pickup all the way through that buying journey and then, hey, you know, checking out, leaving, coming back again? I do think if you're looking at tech stacks now, I mean, it doesn't sound rocket science, but you've got to be looking at how am I going to drive new revenues? You know, is it going to be food delivery apps? Is it going to be adding a takeaway service? Is it going to be some kind of loyalty program to increase repeat visits? And then you've got to be looking at productivity. You've got to be looking at, actually, how can I get my staff back to true hospitality? Like really enjoying their jobs because they're spending time on the wine list or learning what people really want or entertaining people's kids or making sure they're kind of watching, you know, anticipating what they need next. If your staff are spending time printing stuff out, like struggling with data, entering, you know, hours worth of menu updates and things like that, you've got to go for those kind of most inefficient areas first. And a ton of it's customer facing, but a load of it's not as well, right? Like updating menus and things like that. Like a lot of this stuff now can be done with either tech that your partners might have, or if you're more tech forward, like stuff you can play around with yourself. So yeah, staffing will be up there with like the top two things I think we should look at. Otherwise, how on earth are we going to make this an industry that people want to come and work in? Yeah. We need to give them modern tools that's easy to learn so they can get on and build really interesting hospitality skills.
Yeah, totally agree. Thank you, James. So moving on to our next discussion point is around hospitality customer personas and seamless guest ordering. So, well, perhaps for yourself, can you talk a bit about personalization and how important personalization is primarily with Gen Z customers?
Yeah, I mean, times have changed, especially with COVID. Before, you'd have a very little technology in the hospitality, but now more and more people are embracing the technology and are actually actively engaging in transferring the access to their technology. So if somebody says, "Oh, I want to live off the grid," that doesn't happen anymore. You know, you can't live off the grid. So what it is people are saying now, if I get if I give feedback, if I join your loyalty program, what do I get out of it? Do I get a £5 voucher and stuff? And most people will say yes, you know. And then also too, before, you still see some people that are not wanting to touch kiosks. But now, more and more people will go up to the kiosk and you realize that the average spend goes much higher because people see the pictures and they're able to use the technology and you realize that the average spend goes up. If you're using a table technology, the tips go up, they don't go down. So more and more people, both on the customer side and the operations side, are realizing that the technology is actually a huge help to their business.
Thank you, Will. And just picking up on your point around kiosks, we do know from recent surveys that around 91% of Gen Z customers would visit a venue with a kiosk over one without. So Dan, perhaps from your perspective within QikServe, how do you improve the experience with technology?
So I think that comes back to James's point and somewhat Will's point earlier, is your starting point has to be what's your brand experience, not what technology can I throw into a restaurant. Kiosks don't fit in certain brands or certain customer journeys. So that has to be the starting point, is what am I trying to do? And then once you know what you're trying to do, is then thinking about how technology then fits those consumer journeys. I think it's often where the mistakes are made, is just going for the tech first and not the consumer. So for us, we tend to try and be that technology partner that helps navigate those questions for an operator. It's not just always about throwing in a tech product, it's about trying to understand what are you trying to achieve with that. And I think that Gen Z comment, I mean, I've got a teenage son and daughter, and those guys will not talk to anybody, right? they just will not. So I think thinking about that guest experience, thinking about the consumer that's coming ahead, not necessarily the ones that are there today, and really kind of trying to engage on kind of innovating around that. I think that is the key for successful technology. Not starting with it is probably the best way to go.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Dan. So, Will, I'm going to come back to you. I'm sorry. From Noble Group's perspective, we all know within hospitality that customers are eating out less. So how do you make sure as a brand that when customers are eating out, they're coming to you?
Well, there's a lot of different aspects to that question. I mean, first and foremost, right now, our company is spending about 30,000 pounds every month on open table. So, it's not a very healthy relationship at the moment, because they're giving us customers, yes, but we're not getting any data from them. So what we want to do is we want to start weaning off customers, so we get to interact with them and pull them back again and again. So that there's the value in that, but also too, partly in the Noble Group and partly with past companies I've worked with, we're trying to discount people that are already in your restaurant, which you're basically cannibalizing your own sales when you're doing that. So what you want to do is you want to have a product that has the mobile ordering, but also too, that you can do electronic vouchers to pull people in. So if it's somebody's birthday, you don't want to be like, oh, it's your birthday. Here's a free item, or here's 20% off. That person's there. You're not motivating them to come to there. So what you want to do is you want to interact with them and say, hey, it's great to come back. Like, here's a 10-pound voucher to come see us, you know? And that way, you're growing your business. You're not cannibalizing sales you already have, you know? So, I mean, there's that aspect. Like, but yeah, I mean, you want to be able to use the technology to pull people in and keep them there, as opposed to trying to constantly throw out money and not get your return.
Thank you, Will. Okay, so moving on to our next discussion point is surrounding partner ecosystems by overbuild. So perhaps over to Dan and James, first of all, to talk about the QikServe and Stripe partnership. So with the integrated solution that QikServe and Stripe have built today, what USPs does that offer a customer within the hospitality industry?
I'll start and then
go for it.
Yeah, so we've been on this journey to try and simplify payments for operators for at least 5-6 years. One of the biggest things that we always heard back from the partners that we worked with was, how do I reconcile this with that? And often it was creating a lot of admin. And when we were trying to solve for that, we looked at a number of payments vendors, from the downright traditional to the likes of Stripe, to try and find what's going to work best in terms of simplifying it for operators. And in a lot of cases, there's in big operators in particular, there's existing relationships with payment providers, and they're difficult to break. So for us, it was about how do we bring that technology more into our platform so that we give the operator one place to look. And I think as we continued the partnership with Stripe in particular, we just found their technology more easily adaptable and more easily integrated into our platform, that then enabled us to build better operator experiences than we'd ever had before. So for example, you can refund an online order or a bill payment directly from our platform. You don't need to go to a Stripe dashboard or a Lloyd's card net or whatever dashboard to do that refund. We suck in all of the transactional reports now. So if you want to see your payout report, you can go to our dashboard and you'll see your payout report. You don't need to go to Stripe, or you don't need to go to your kind of existing merchant provider. And I think those are just two examples. We've done a huge amount on fraud with Stripe's help. I think that's been transformational across our business. So from an operator perspective, it's probably one of the biggest challenges with online payments is how do you make sure that those transactions that are coming through are valid and not going to be challenged at a later point.
Yeah,
and look, from our side, I mean, I think if you are a fast-growing business, you may decide to work with Stripe Direct, but you're going to need a developer or two, right? You're going to need some of that technical expertise, and at the going rate, you could probably bring in 4 or 5 or 6 frontline staff for that kind of cost. So I think more and more, even quite ambitious companies are going to be turning to, you know, the kind of leading startups like QikServe or that you see around here and going, I just want this one-stop shop. I don't quite know what it's going to look like a year from now, but I'm guessing it's going to be this mix of, you know, people ordering ahead or people ordering from food apps or reserving for Open Table and maybe paying a reservation fee. And then when they land, okay, well, some might order for a kiosk, some might already have my app, some might hate apps and do a QR code, some might want to be at the bar. So I think, you know, watch the roadmaps of people like QikServe, because it's, you know, they're trying to build these businesses as fast as you need them. And what Stripe have is a whole toolkit of payment tools. So we do terminals, which you could put on a bar or give to waiting staff. You can attach it to a terminal and have it right there. But our real expertise is in that online space. For a single site, it would be about actually the tech behind QikServe's kind of QR codes or paying ahead and embedding it into loyalty. But where it really starts to come into its own is when you've got a whole portfolio, right? If you're running 100 different stores and you're a finance team and you want to understand what's happening in each of my different restaurants, bars, cafes, you know, Stripe Connect is a technology that we built with, you know, with the food delivery apps, with the kind of platforms that do things like grocery delivery and line bikes and all of that stuff. But this idea of connected ecosystems, what's happening on each of my sites, like that's the kind of insights you want to get, going to want to gather. You've got a choice. You can take it raw or you can work with a partner like QikServe who are already making it in a single dashboard, easy to use, easier to train your staff. And just focus in on the core, you know, 6 to 10 jobs you really need to run the ops of your business. So I think you'll see more and more partners working behind the scenes, trying to make your experience as operators easier over the next couple of years, because running a hospitality business is hard enough as is.
Can I compliment one thing that
sure.
what James just said? Like, you need to have integrations, because, and I've seen it in the past where you've got 5 different systems. You've got your stock, you've got your tills, you've got your credit card statements, and you run 5 reports, and each one has 5 different numbers. And so then you have to spend, your accounting team is almost reconciling everything more than actually doing what they're supposed to do. So what you want to do is find a solution that has one point of truth, and so you don't have to kind of run back and forth and figure out which one is the correct one.
And I'd say it's going to get more complicated, right? You know, your customers will want to be ordering on different food apps. They're building their own brand. They're building their own loyalty program. So if you're not on the next channel, you're going to really struggle to capture customers. You're going to really struggle to keep up with where the demand is. And that's everything from, yeah, Google Maps, OpenTable, Resy, to ordering ahead on Just Eats and Deliveroos. It's a universe that's going to expand. And each one of them is going to maybe start trying to be a bit of a closed shop, or, you know, log in to get your data. But inevitably, they realize they have to plug into your technology stack. So you need to be with leading partners like a QikServe and others that are out there, because they're the ones that are going to manage those integrations for you. But that's the ultimate acid test of a partner. You know, how few are things you're logging into? How simple is it for your staff? And of the main jobs you've got to get done right through that staff journey, like, who's the best partner that keeps it simple for your team?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we only have a few more minutes left on our panel this afternoon, so we would really like to open up the opportunity to the audience and take any questions that anyone may have. If you do have a question, please raise your hand. And I believe there's a girl up the back with a microphone.
I wanted to ask, you know, about your point around reconciling data. So having this digital transformation, having your platform...
Sorry, sir. I don't think that microphone's working.
Oh, really? Okay, sorry.
Better. Apologies for that.
So I just wanted to talk to you about the point you raised about reconciling data. Having that end-to-end digital transformation done in your business, how much of that repetitive manual task was removed out of the system? So where you might be doing 50%, how far down have you gone?
Tons. But I mean, what it is if you don't have systems that talk to each other, basically it's very difficult to reconcile the two. You know, what you want to have is the knowledge that this data is flowing over, and so you don't get anything lost. And that's all got to do with the integrations. If you don't have integrations, then all of your efforts are trying to get the two to balance. So once the integration's in place, you don't have to worry about it too much after that.
And I would just add that sometimes it's quite a hidden benefit, right? So you're talking about finance teams that are working better, marketing teams that are working better. So you're not always able to, dare I say, get rid of a headcount, but you might be able to spin up new projects. You might be able to get onto the next piece of innovation. And likewise, in the restaurant, hopefully the waiting staff will be replacing the kind of manual, tedious stuff they're doing with being foot forward and actually doing great hospitality. So sometimes quite hard to get to that true ROI, right? I think, but I think the team will feel it in engagement scores.
Just to jump into that. Will's point about integrations is absolutely critical. I mean, I think our platform has like over 120 integrations on it. And it's that that kind of brings this the seamless digital experience and helps you guys with digital transformation. But don't underestimate what the front ends can do. We're working with a US brand with 500 restaurants, QSR restaurants, and we're helping them to roll out kiosk. Started with the customer journey, like still heavily cash dependent, so we've integrated a cash handler, lots of gift cards, vouchers, making sure all those things talk to each other before you go into a full rollout is absolutely critical, because otherwise you just create other problems later on. And the benefit for them is they're anticipating needing at least one cashier for each store that they run, and in some stores they'll take out two. They'll need two less cashiers, and then if you add the increased spend that you're getting from a kiosk, the ROI then really kind of ramps up really, really quickly.
Thank you.
Perfect.
Thank you, sir. Okay, so we're running into our last minute, but happy to take any further questions if anyone has any. No? Great. Okay, well, thank you everyone for joining. The QuickServe team can be found at stand H2161, and we would absolutely be delighted to take the opportunity to talk about our QuickServe digital ordering solution in further detail with anyone who's interested. So thank you all for attending, and enjoy the rest of your day.